In 1970, a television program debuted that changed the way millions of people looked at faith. The Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice.
Featuring the ministry of Robert Schuller, taught a generation that through God's love, your scars can be turned into stars. It was an idea that launched the most popular, inspirational television program of its time. And today, the Hour of Power continues with a new voice for a new generation.
When you put your trust in God, nothing can stop you.
Pastor Bobby Schuller will encourage you and share a message that can give you a new perspective on life. Because whatever your circumstance or the obstacles you face, this moment can be your Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
Welcome, welcome. We are so happy to have you. Do we have anybody who it's their first time or they're from out of state or out of country? Would you raise your hand? Yeah, welcome. We are so honored to have you. Would you turn around and shake the hand of the person next to you and say, God loves you and so do I.
All right, well, we're so glad you're here. We're going to have fun today. We're going to rejoice in the real presence of the kingdom of God. And let's begin by praying. Father, we thank you that we are in your world. This is the Father's world, and we trust that we're, no matter what darkness that we're in, we can stop worrying, we can stop hurrying, and in the name of Jesus, we can be patient and wait for your Holy Spirit to do the hard work of breaking chains and creating new tomorrows. So we thank you, Lord, that we walk in hope and in faith today. No matter what storm, no matter how cold it gets, we trust that you are faithful, you're good. And it's in Jesus' name we come rejoicing today. Amen.
Amen. preparation for Bobby's message this morning, the words of our Lord, found in Isaiah. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the days of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. May we rejoice today, knowing God will get us, his children, to our destinies.
Weary soul rejoices, for yonder
My guest today is Laura Lynn Thompson, co-host of the National Daily Show, The 700 Club in Canada. She has interviewed hundreds of celebrities and many great men and women of faith, but Laura Lynn has an inspiring story of her own. After a series of personal crises, God pulled her out of her brokenness and led her to where she is today. Please welcome with me Laura Lynn Thompson. Hi, Laura.
Hi, what an extreme honor it is. This beautiful, beautiful place and your music and your worship. It's just a privilege to be here.
Well, we're so glad to have you here. And of course, we're in Canada. We have a big following in Canada, and so it's always great to have somebody from our northern brothers and sisters. And
yes, it's just a lot warmer.
Yeah,
here. A lot warmer. And down here. We have been enjoying the weather. Somebody from here said it was cold. Yeah. Yesterday, and we're like, this is not cold.
Well, it was close to this morning, 61 degrees, when I woke up.
And beautiful.
I washes and
61. Can't get better. Wow.
So, but now you, you're Canadian, but you weren't born in Canada. You're born in Uganda?
I was born in Uganda, East Africa, small white child, Bobby. And I had missionary parents. I spent 8 years in Uganda. Idi Amin came into power, you might remember, back in the 70s. And he brutalized 500,000 of his own people in Uganda. They came and they picked my dad up one night in 1973 from our home, and they gave us about 48 hours to get out of the country. And I was almost 8, and that was when my life drastically changed, you know, along with my parents. We left Uganda. I remember, though, that the people there loved God. They loved to worship. I grew up in a culture of worship, and so my heart was blessed. I remember my dad preaching one day and just inviting people to come to the altar and to pray. And as a 6-year-old girl, I had tears streaming down my face, and I said, God, use my life, make my life significant. I pray that you will honor the destiny and the calling that you have put within me, formed in my mother's womb. I understood the scriptures, and so we got home to Canada. We went up to Tuktoyaktuk. I knew what God said about who we were. I knew what he said about our sin and that he had removed it as far away as the east is from the west. But as I got older and I met a young man, and I decided that he would be marrying me, so I let him know that. And I planned the date, I planned the wedding, I told him what he'd be wearing, and I said, just show up, it's gonna be great. And so I put my arm inside my dad's arm, the doors opened of the wedding day, and I began walking down that aisle, the best, most beautiful dress I'd ever had, 200 guests, you know, invited, and I'm walking down the aisle, and I look up at that man, and all I could think was, who is that? And why did I decide that I needed to get married? I'm pretty immature for a getting to be half century gal. And my parents knew that. And they had said, you know, do you really think you're ready? You're just 21. Why don't you wait? And I said, no, I'm ready to fly. I've done everything right. I don't smoke. I don't drink. I haven't had sex before I got married. And I am going to marry that man. Who is that man? And so I got up to the front and, you know, we said our vows. And that day I said, well, I don't feel a thing. I don't know why I'm doing this, but by golly, I have made this covenant and I'm going to keep it. Well, what's a girl to do when she's in the church and she's vulnerable and she's foolish and she's got some rebellion in her heart that doesn't listen to authority? She does love God and she does want to do what's right, but in the end, she's made some decisions in her vulnerability, in her brokenness. As 1 year led to another, Bobby, the pain just grew worse. It was very, very clear that I had made a decision in my humanity and in my error that was not going well. As 1 year turned into 2 years, we went to our pastoral staff. We said, we're not doing well. Do you think you can help? They said, we think it's going to take professionals for you. And so I then went out and sought professional help, and we started trying to get, you know, some remedy to this mess. At about year 5, I made it even worse. I took on actions that brought about the demise of that marriage. And there was no turning back. There was no putting it together. As they say about Humpty Dumpty, he sat on a wall, and when he had a great fall, all the king's horses and all the king's men
couldn't put Humpty together again. And my life laid in shambles. As I was heading for divorce, I began to be so broken inside, asking God how he would ever fix this. You see, I was supposed to be a somebody. So I embraced that. I should have done well. I had a missionary family. I knew the word, and I had messed up. The depression began to come over my life, and the enemy, you know, the accuser of the brethren, who knows who you are, because when the enemy sees the thumbprint of God on your life, he then puts a bullseye on your forehead, and he told me, you're done in. You'll never do anything for God. You're disqualified. Your sin has rendered you useless in the kingdom of God, and that depression sunk over my soul 3 to 4 years, Bobby. I couldn't stand it. If this is what I had created, this is the mess that I would live in, and I would never be free.
You know, there's so many people listening to you today, and many people are saying, like, they're stuck, and God did turn that around, didn't he?
Well, the number one lie that the enemy wants you to think is that because of that secret sin, because of that abortion, because of the adultery, because of that addiction in your life, that you're disqualified. There's three people that always know what happened in your life. There's yourself, you can't seem to forget it. There's God, who says he's forgotten it already, and he's putting it, has already put it in the sea of forgetfulness. And then there's the enemy, who says and reminds you day and night. He is the accuser of the brethren. I was so broken, Bobby. So what happened was one night, and this was about 1996, I was in my second failing marriage. There was no hope that I was going to be any good to the kingdom. And I got my shoes on and I headed to a Wednesday night service. And I cried again because the brokenness was so overwhelming. I didn't know how I'd ever get out of it. I walked into the church that night, and like your beautiful cross here, there was a cross that he had brought up, a very rugged cross. And he asked all of us, after we sang a few songs, if we would write our three most prominent sins onto this piece of paper, and then if we would get into a lineup and head to the cross and nail it in. Well, I was not happy about that, because I did not want to write my sins down. I had nothing but two broken marriages, a huge mess, a disaster. I should have been a contender, and all I was the fallen, broken woman. So as I got closer, the Holy Spirit, and this is the beautiful part, and I'm almost done, Bobby. This is the beautiful part, is the Holy Spirit whispered a couple of questions to me that changed my life. You see, I knew the Word of God. I knew that he removed my sins. I knew that he covered me. I knew that Jesus had died on the cross. But as I looked up at that cross and I could almost see his bloodied, broken, bruised body, beaten beyond recognition with a spear that had caused blood to go down his side and blood dripping from his head. And I looked up at that, and the Holy Spirit said this to me, was what Jesus did on that cross just not enough for you? Must he die again so that you would finally receive the freedom that he's already paid the price to give you? And you see, in that moment, I went, oh my goodness. It's like I have put my sin up here and the power of the cross and what Jesus did down here, when what Jesus did is up here and my sin is down here, and he is the ultimate contender, and he is just like Rocky. He's better than Rocky, and he has paid a price so high that this sin is demolished forever. I got it. It was my arrogance. It was my pride that could not receive what Christ had done for me. I was set free. I walked up to that cross. I smashed that nail, and I mean, I'm not good at hitting nails, you know, with hammers, and so I smashed that so many times, the pastor later had to turn around and say, who is that person? Who is that big sinner woman who is smashing that nail into that cross so hard and so loud? And I determined that day that when Jesus said, it is finished, he didn't mean it's finished, this weekend's over, I've done what I had to do. No, he meant it is finished. The sin that Laura Lynn will do in 2,000 years from now, it is finished. The sin of every one of us, the broken place that the enemy accuses you of, it is finished, it's done. And I walked away a free girl that day. And from that day to this, God called me, amen.
Good.
Amen.
All right.
Praise God.
The book is Relentless Redemption. Laura Lynn, thank you so much for being here today. God bless
you. God bless you. God bless.
As we approach the end of the year, we'll be putting our plans for 2017 into action. To sign off from 2016 and face the new year, it is important that we pay all of our bills. Hour of Power in Australia has continued for 40 years because of appreciative, caring friends who support us so that we can bring you this weekly church service. Today, I'm asking on behalf of the thousands of individuals that rely on these weekly programs if you will give a year-end gift of $60, representing $5 a month for every month of 2016. Bobby would like to send you a choice of one of these creative and inspiring devotional books with an entire year's worth of daily reflections. The all-time ministry favorites, Tough-Minded Faith for Tender-Hearted People, Start or Finish Your Day with 366 Steps on a Walk of Faith. We also have the Power for Life devotional, which includes a stunning pantograph taken by our friend Ken Duncan. Or you could choose A Positive Minute Volume 1, which contains a selection of devotions written by members of the Schuller family. To thank you for your year-end gift of $60 or more, we'll send you your selected devotional book, or if you can send a year-end gift of $120 or more, we will also send you your choice of a second devotional book, together with Ken Duncan's super-sized gift book, Acts of the Apostles. Please contact us on 1300 363 114 or write to us, PO Box 1407, North Sydney 2059. Or hourofpower.org.au, and you can find us on Facebook, Hour of Power Australia.
And who wrote the song the angels are singing to welcome this precious son?
Who scheduled this holy moment in time long before time began?
And who holds the power of heaven and earth in the palm of his great hand? This child is the one. This child is the one. Heaven's King of glory, Mary's little son. Judah's mighty lion, it is this child. This child is the one. And when all that will ever be said is said, all that will ever be done is done, who will receive the power and the riches?
tomorrow is my daughter's birthday, Haven. And she's here today. And there is this little song that we sing in the car all the time from Frozen. You might know we're just down the street from Disneyland, and she and I sing this all the time, and I knew today we were gonna have the Christmas orchestra. And so I asked her, what about for your birthday if we sang that duet together? And she said yes. So we're gonna do that this morning. Haven, come on up. Now, neither one of us are pros. We're just a couple of bums, you know, who like karaoke, right? But I asked Mark, and Mark was like, absolutely. Haven, how old are you gonna be tomorrow?
6.
All right, are you ready? Okay.
Okay, tonight is something crazy.
I love crazy.
My life has been a series of doors in my face. And suddenly I bump into you.
I was thinking the same thing, cause like, I've been searching my whole life to find my own place. And maybe it's the party talking or the chocolate fondue.
But with you,
I find my place.
And
it's nothing like I've ever known before. Love is an open door.
Love is an open door.
Life can be so much more. It's crazy
what?
How we finish each other's
sandwiches.
That's what I was gonna say.
Find
someone who makes so much like me. Jinx! Jinx again!
Our
mental synchronization could have but one explanation. You
and I were just meant to be.
Say goodbye to the pain of the past.
We
don't need to feel it anymore. Love is an open.
Well, good morning. We hope you're having fun today. For those of you who are watching on television, we just want you to know Shepherd's Grove is a movement of God's people that are inviting new people to this celebration every day. We are living every moment in the Father's world, and we want you to come and join us. No matter who you are, we want you to know that we like people here at Shepherd's Grove. And so no matter what you're going through, we want you to know that this is a safe place to be who you are in the midst of your challenges and become a happy and whole student of Jesus. If you're watching on TV, we hope you come down and worship with us. We're here every single morning, and we'd love to be a part of your spiritual family. Friends, would you stand with me? We're going to say this confession together. Hold your hands out like this. I'm not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God. It's who I am. No one can take it from me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world. Thanks. You can be seated. Now, unfortunately, I have actually had the flu the last 3 days. So all day Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, I was sick in bed. And I put together a little something today. I emailed the team last night with some slides. But today I'm really going to be speaking more from the heart, meaning that I haven't prepared as much as I normally am. So have a bit of grace with me. But I really just want to speak from the heart. I want to begin, as we've been in this series of Advent, Advent is a time in which you're waiting for something. It's a time that we acknowledge that all of us in the human condition are in a weird place of waiting, and we don't quite always know what it is that we're waiting for. And so Advent means the arrival. It means that that thing you've been waiting for has come. And so for us, Advent becomes a time in which we build up within ourselves hope. That Jesus himself becomes a symbol and the actual reality of all the things that we hope for. And that as we wait in the milieu of life, you know, the suffering of sickness or poverty or the other challenges that we face, and in the midst of all of that, we serve the kind of God who breaks into darkness. As J.R.R. Tolkien, we learned a new word a few weeks ago, eucatastrophe. That is, that at the last second of the last minute of the last hour, somehow God tends to break through and bring us the miracle we need. So Advent is a time of training into our soul rhythms and a spirit of hope. And so there are four promises I wrote down that I wanted to talk about, four promises of Advent. And we're talking about the third promise today. And the third promise is this: God will get you to your destiny. God will get you to your destiny. Today I want to talk about the idea that although all of us have a calling in God, too often we're focused on our calling and not our character. And that if you focus on your character, God will focus on your calling. There is a huge, looming fear in all people that, well, when it's all said and done, I didn't do anything with my life that truly mattered. Almost all of us live with a daily fear that my life won't matter, that I need to do something spectacular. And this is a big challenge. And it seems like the wealthier our nations become, the more this existential question becomes a major issue for us. And so I just want to begin by saying this. In the kingdom of God, no matter what you accomplish, your life matters. Can we just say that? That no matter what you do, no matter what trophies you have on the wall, no matter what you can say at your retirement party, or even what you can say on your deathbed, no matter what you accomplish, your life matters. Your life matters because you are loved by God. And that's very good news. And too often we think that our lives, we have to earn something to make our lives worth anything. So many of us were like, we're so scared that our life's not going to matter. That our life's not going to matter. And it does. It always matters. There is this modern thing that says, do something great with your life. And you should. You should do something great with your life. But when you do something great with your life, it doesn't make your life worth more. There's a great book called The Denial of Death, written in the 1970s by a guy named Ernest Becker. And Ernest Becker had this idea. He was a psychologist and a philosopher. His book won the Pulitzer Prize. And he had this idea that most of mankind was obsessed with building symbols and stories to construct in their own lives a sense of immortality. That underneath the surface for almost every human being was this looming, and he used the word, dread. This ongoing fear that I'm going to die someday. I'm so afraid of dying. And that a lot of civilization was built around constructing essentially a sense of immortality. That even though I will die, my name will carry on, or my death will have meaning. He called this journey for the human being the hero project. That all of us have this little hero project that if we can build out of our lives a sense of heroism, well, then our lives are going to matter. And he says that this is a problem because what you're doing is actually trying to deny and distract yourself from the idea that someday you're going to die. This is a bit dark, isn't it? It gets better, I promise. And so all of us, so he believed that much, if not most, pathology was rooted in this this deep sense of dread, this fear of death that every single human being has. And he was working off of Kierkegaard, and he said, the only time you can truly be healthy is when you abandon this hero project and embrace faith. And that faith that I'm going to live on beyond this life, that's the only hope that truly makes you healthy. And the irony about this book was that Ernest Becker himself was Jewish, but he was agnostic. And he sort of laments at the end of the book, but I don't have that faith. And I think in our modern world, science is trying to help in this role of giving meaning, but they're not doing a very good job. And he basically said, I don't think they're going to accomplish helping give meaning to people who don't believe in an afterlife. And that's kind of how it ends. As a digression, by the way, Ernest Becker later on gets in a written conversation with a youth pastor who actually ends up sort of converting him to Orthodox Judaism. I don't know if it was Orthodox, but he came to a deep faith in his Jewish roots, and so he had some kind of faith when he died. But I guess I just want to begin there because I think many Christians who forget about the truth of heaven and the ceaselessness of the soul and the fact that regardless of what you accomplish, your life matters, very often we fall into the hero project trap. Many of us, we don't truly have faith in God, faith in heaven. And so for many of us, we want to do great things, not for others. We want to do great things not to benefit the world truly, but in order to build our hero project, in order to distract ourselves from a looming fear of death. And I just want to challenge you that this is not the role for Christians. That Christians should not be building a hero project. That we should do great things and we should actually be heroes, but not for ourselves and not to build some kind of symbolic immortality. We know that there is a heaven and we know God is faithful and we know He is our Father. And just like any father wouldn't abandon his kids, we know God won't abandon us. Amen? The more you can build that knowledge into your soul, that you're a ceaseless being with an eternal destiny in God's good universe, as Dallas Willard said, the less you worry about always doing something spectacular and fantastic. That's a big concern, isn't it? I mean, I just feel that so many people are so worried that I'm going to die and my life is not going to matter. And I just think about all the good people in the past who knew the Lord that had simple lives, that were farmers or they worked the same job all of their lives, but they were faithful to the gospel and they knew Jesus and they loved the Lord. Did their lives matter? Of course they did. Every life matters. And guess what? Not all of us are going to be Julius Caesar or Brad Pitt or the President of the United States, okay? There's only a handful of people in history are going to do that. And in the kingdom of God, they're the lowest. That's what Jesus teaches us. That if you want to be the greatest, you become a servant, that you become humble and you become like Jesus. And there will be a day when we get to heaven that we'll see that that makes sense. And so I just want to begin by saying, don't worry. Your life matters, not because of what you do. Your life matters because you're a human being and you're loved by God. You're treasured. All right, can we just establish that? Okay, I don't mean to hammer it home, but I just want to say this. On that one point, you know, I was just sang here with Haven. Do you think I love Haven more because she sang with me? Do any of you who are parents love your kids more when they do cool things? No, you're proud of them, you think it's great, you applaud them, but do you love them more? Absolutely not. God does not value you or love you more because of your trophies. So let's talk about calling, okay? But all of us do have a calling, and I just want to say four things before I actually get into the text. Four things about reflections on calling. Number one, I just want to say that all of us have more than one calling. All of us have more than one calling. We always think that there's this one great thing we're supposed to do in life. I'm supposed to write a best-selling novel. I'm supposed to become the senator of California. You know, you come up with these ideas of things that, these great things that it's going to say in your grave or whatever, but let me just tell you that all of us have multiple callings all the time that God calls us to do this, and later he calls us to do that. Think about Jesus. We always think that Jesus had one calling, but he didn't really start his ministry until he was 30. Jesus, as a child, was a faithful student. And then later, he was a faithful carpenter. And he built things, and he had to work with people constantly. And all of that time, God was preparing him for the next calling, which was to be a rabbi. And even then, think about Jesus. He had 12 disciples. He's from a little podunk part of the empire that nobody really cared about. He wasn't even from Jerusalem. He was from like the northern outskirts. You know, but that was his calling, and God used those things for major, major, obviously, to change the whole world. So you never have just one calling. Number two, every calling comes to an end. This is maybe one of the saddest things, because for many of us, when we're doing what God has called us to do, we say, I'm doing what I was born to do. Sometimes it suddenly comes to an end. We get fired, or we get an injury, or sick, or a divorce, or some twist happens in the plot, and we just weren't expecting that, and we think, but that's what I was called to do. How could God let this happen? But every calling comes to an end. No matter where you are in life, you are in a season. And seasons come and seasons go. And that should give you hope, because if you're in a place of sort of an in-betweenness, well, God still has another calling for you. Number three, and I already said this, but your calling is not your identity. You know, I may be a pastor, and that's what I'm called to do at this time, but someday I may not be a pastor. And that's not who I am. If what we do vocationally or what we do for a living becomes a part of our identity, then our soul is on a roller coaster, because if that thing gets taken away from us, we lose our sense of who we are. And so our life becomes fragmented as we try and search for a new identity. The one thing that will never change in your life is that you are loved. That God loves you and never stop loving you. There's nothing you can do to change that. That is the constant. And if our lives are rooted in that truth, we will have a deep sense of peace and joy in everything else we do. Amen? Number four, and this is the thing I really want you to hear. If you're alive, you have a calling. If you're alive, you have a calling. I just want to say this. You didn't miss out on your calling. And you say, you don't understand, I've been giving a week to live. You didn't miss out on your calling. You don't understand, I went through a divorce. You didn't miss out on your calling. You don't understand, I kind of feel like I've lost my faith. I don't know where I'm going. You didn't miss out on your calling. You have a calling right now. God's calling you to do something. It doesn't matter how old you are, sick, poor, uneducated, young. You have a calling. Look, there's nothing more inspiring than seeing people at the end of their rope pursuing knowledge, pursuing growth, and pursuing God's best for others. I remember Dennis Prager was telling a story about how he used to visit hospice, and he said, there's nothing more inspiring than going around seeing these people who are on their deathbed, and they were encouraging one another, they were writing letters, they were sitting there reading the newspaper, people who love to learn. These are people, I think, who had a love for knowledge, and might even be people who understood, if I've got a day left, I'm going to use it. Look, if you're alive, you're alive for a reason. If you're alive, you have a calling. And that's very, very good news. One of my favorite movies that came out last year was this movie, The Interview, about, it was like with Robert De Niro. And he's this retired guy. You know, he did really well in his corporate world, and it begins with him in retirement. And he says, you know, I've done everything. I've done Chinese classes. I've done dating. I've done golfing. You know, I've done yoga, I've done swing dancing. And he said, and I'm just bored to death. And finally, this guy, in the story, he goes back to this big firm to be the intern, to be the guy at the bottom of the rung. And plot twist here, you know, the narrative is that that he's eventually used to coach the CEO of a company. So he's sort of used in this narrative. He comes in at the very bottom just to be a servant, but he realizes he's not at the end of his rope. Many of you, you're retired, and you might find out, you just feel like you're bored, and you just maybe you're trying to have more fun or travel more, and that's great, but I just want to encourage you, even if you're retired, you still have a calling. And although this is a good time to have fun and to be with your grandkids and those types of things, you're at the best peak of your life when it comes to knowledge. You know more now than you've ever known. You're in the perfect place for God to use you in phenomenal ways. No matter how old you are, you have a calling. I remember when I was in college, there was this guy, and he decided that everyone at this home near our school, he's like, they still have a purpose. And he went down there and he created a prayer team. And he started taking these prayer requests that would come into ORU from all around the world, and he'd bring them in. And this table of saints would sit around this table, and they would pray by faith with power every day, spiritually breaking chains in the lives of others, that even though they weren't physically able to leave that space, God was using them to break spiritual chains. They believed, and I believe, that no matter who you are, if you're alive, you have a calling. Believe it. Believe it. So, you say, well, what is my calling? And I just say, I don't know. I don't know. Can't help you there. God knows, and he'll show you if you listen. But I want to say this. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about your calling. Worry about your character. If you focus on your character, God will focus on your calling. If you work on being a Jesus kind of person, you'll have so much opportunity come to you, you'll have to shake it away with a stick. In fact, people that who have built into themselves the character of Christ, their biggest challenge is saying no to all of the people that want help from them. If you become a Jesus kind of person, you'll automatically be a healing presence everywhere you go, and people will want more from you, and then you're going to have to practice boundaries. You're not going to be asking God, what's my calling? You're going to be thinking, stop calling me to so much stuff. I have to say no. If you focus on your character, God will focus on your calling. If you focus on your character, God will focus on your calling. Forget about your calling. Don't worry about it. Worry about what kind of person you want to be. And God will prepare you for the next season of purpose in your life. Amen? Amen. And that's what I'm basing this off of the story. I finally get to the scripture at the end of my sermon. There's this great Advent story when God is preparing the way for Jesus. And it's this old priest named Zechariah. Zechariah is an old man, and his wife Elizabeth is an old woman. And he has worked in this temple forever. They have probably maybe 1,000 priests working in this temple, and they're always taking turns. And what happens is every day, each team gets to roll the dice, and one person from that group gets to go and burn incense. If a priest is lucky, he will burn incense in a 40-year period once in his life. And here's Zechariah. He's in the temple, and the lots are cast, and it comes to him. Once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Thousands of people turn to look at him, and he ascends the stairs to go into the holy place of the temple. And there he goes to burn incense before the Lord. And as he's going in, it's like, imagine being Zechariah. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, amazing experience. I've waited my whole life. I'm an old man. I've seen thousands of priests do this. It's finally my turn. As he's walking up, you can hear people outside singing and saying things, and you might hear a roar. Whoa, whoa, whoa. I mean, it's this really intense spiritual moment. I can't imagine being more expectant for God to do something. And he steps in and he goes in, and of course, there's an angel standing waiting for him. He says, Zechariah, I have a message for you. You're going to have a son, and his name's going to be John. This is the foretelling, by the way, of John the Baptist. John the Baptist was the man who went before Jesus and prepared the way, a super important character in the story of the Gospels and the story of Jesus. And he says to Zechariah, you're going to have the son, and his name will be John. And Zechariah says kind of like, he's this old Jewish guy, and he's like, I don't know how that can be, pretty old. You know? And my wife, she's pretty old too. I don't know. And the funny thing about the story is, like, and now I'm putting this into the story, but I assume when I'm reading this text that this is a character issue for Zechariah. The scriptures say that Zechariah and Elizabeth were righteous people, that they were good in God's eyes, that they did what was right. But, you know, you kind of imagine that there's this doubt and that there's this sort of response of Zechariah to speak doubt into something. And I think, you know, if it's a once-in-a-lifetime chance that I roll the dice, a 1 out of 1,000, that I'm going to go into the temple, then I want to go into the temple, there's an angel there, and the angel says something, and I'm like, I don't know, it just doesn't seem likely, I don't know. It seems like there might be a character issue there. And so what I think, and I'm putting this into the text, but I think the character issue is cynicism. I think he's a cynic. I think as an old man, he's probably been disappointed, and he probably wanted a kid, and he's been shooting it down. And so what happens in the story? The angel mutes him. He mutes him until a son is born. The first thing he's able to say is his name will be John. And the reason I wanted to just finish with the story is this. God actually took care of Zechariah's character, his cynicism issue, so that he could take care of his calling. All that to simply say, friends, focus on your character and God will get you to your calling. Look at the habits in your life, the little things, and devote your life to becoming more like Jesus, to becoming a Sermon on the Mount kind of person. Do everything you can to live and be more like Jesus, and God will get you to your calling. And today I just want to say, you can stop worrying about it. Don't worry about your calling. Worry about your character. And I'll just finish. When we've seen this quote before, just one quote from Dallas Willard at the end. This is his prayer. Lord, don't give me more success than my character can handle. If that's a hard prayer to pray, congratulations, you're a human being. It's hard for all of us to pray that, but the harder it is for you to pray, the more you need to focus on your character and the less you need to focus on succeeding. If you focus on your character, God will prepare you for your destiny. Don't worry about your destiny. God's going to get you there, and it is good. And if you trust in the name of Jesus, your future is always bright, even when your present is dark. If you trust in the chain-breaking name of Jesus Christ, you will get to your good destiny. I promise. You don't have to worry. Focus on your character. Become more like Jesus, and God will get you where you need to be. Amen?
Amen.
All right, would you pray with me? In Jesus' name, Lord, we pray that you'd forgive us of our sins, that you'll renew us, and that you'd make us Jesus kind of people. I pray, Father, that you'd fill us with your Holy Spirit. You'd help us to understand that this is your world and to give us faith that no matter what, we don't have to worry. That you want us to do great things, but I pray that you prepare our hearts and minds so when those great things come, we have the character to endure them and fulfill them. Lord, we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thanks, friends, for being here. I hope that you leave encouraged, renewed, and restored. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Isn't it wonderful that we can share in the ministry of Hour of Power all the way from Shepherd's Grove in the United States? If you have enjoyed the program or if you want to know more about the ministry of Hour of Power, please contact us. We'd love to hear from you. You can contact us by phone 1300 363 114 or mail us at PO Box 1407, North Sydney 2059. Go online at hourofpower.org.au or you can find us on Facebook, Hour of Power Australia. As we approach the end of the year, we'll be putting our plans for 2017 into action. To sign off from 2016 and face the new year, it is important that we pay all of our bills. Hour of Power in Australia has continued for 40 years because of appreciative, caring friends who support us so that we can bring you this weekly church service. Today, I'm asking on behalf of the thousands of individuals that rely on these weekly programs if you will give a year-end gift of $60, representing $5 a month for every month of 2016. Bobby would like to send you a choice of one of these creative and inspiring devotional books, with an entire year's worth of daily reflections, the all-time ministry favourites, tough-minded faith for tender-hearted people, start or finish your day with 366 steps on a walk of faith. We also have the Power for Life devotional, which includes a stunning pantograph taken by our friend Ken Duncan. Or you could choose a Positive Minute Volume 1, which contains a selection of devotions written by members of the Schuller family. To thank you for your year-end gift of $60 or more, we'll send you your selected devotional book, or if you can send a year-end gift of $120 or more, we will also send you your choice of a second devotional book, together with Ken Duncan's super-sized gift book, Acts of the Apostles. Please contact us on 1300 363 114 or write to us, PO Box 1407, North Sydney 2059. Or hourofpower.org.au, and you can find us on Facebook, Hour of Power Australia. We love hearing from you, so please send us your prayer requests, or perhaps you would love some ministry materials. You are all part of our Hour of Power community in Australia. So from me, Sam Haddon, God loves you, and so do we.